now a short introduction from the producer's legal representative, Mr. Abe Appenheimer.
Hello, and welcome to this documentary containing new and exclusive interviews with the five surviving members of Monty Python. The producers wish to make it clear that any views or opinions expressed herein are those of the individual speaking and hold no truth whatsoever. Pursuant, therefore, to Clause 4.6 of the Broadcasting Video Television Act 1989, subsection 4, 3 and 2, Clause...
Subject to clause 4.123, no viewer or watcher may copy, repeat, impersonate, mime, either contextually or non-contextually, any material whatsoever in any public place, such as a street, pub, club, meeting, room, Baptist church, tunnel.
The legend they called Python. At first they were small, then they grew up to be tall. The world heard of their fame, everyone knew their name. Now it's who the fuck are Python? Never bleeding heard of them. That's why we made this documentary.
Thought it would go to America. And I can remember a guy from WGBH in Boston, the PBS station in Boston, coming and meeting us and sitting in a little room, a little projection theater, and he said he was very excited and he'd heard wonderful things and he wanted to see the show. And he'd had to come in those days because there were not DVDs flying around, they hadn't been invented. And he sat with us, and when the lights went up at the end of the second show, he was sitting there as though he'd seen a ghost. I mean, he was pale. And we said, And he said, yeah. And he got up and walked out of the room and said, it's been a great pleasure meeting you guys. He was so frightened at what would happen to his career if he put this on in America. And then there was a lovely woman called Nancy Lewis who pushed us by showing people our records and got some of the people in the American record industry interested.
The problem in those days was that nobody could afford to put it on public television. They couldn't afford to convert it from the PAL system to NTSC, which was a very expensive process in those days. And one day I got a phone call from Greg Garrison. He was a man who had produced Dean Martin's show and had a big success record. And they were putting together a show which I believe was called World of Comedy. And primarily it was going to be made up of sketches from comedy shows all over the world. And they wanted to use some Monty Python clips in there. The Pythons, at that stage were really reluctant to let anybody take clips from their shows. But I remember writing them a rather impassioned memo saying, look, this is a summer replacement show. Nobody will see it. And they only want to use little clips, and they pay a lot of money, which would be paid to Time Life. That would pay to convert it. And after that, the PBS stations could afford it.
And I think it was 74, before a very great pal of ours called Ron DeVilliers, who was in charge of the PBS station in Dallas, finally plucked up his courage. And one night, he put us out in Dallas, of all places. And, you know, all his friends were calling him the next morning from the PBS station saying, what happened? You know, were you stoned on the way to work? Did they set fire to the station? He says, it's all right. There's no protest. And then it went out everywhere.
When the Python thing came on, it was much better. Let's say it was a whole lot better than having to watch a sitcom.
30! All right, cut him down, Mr. Fuller.
Oh, you're no fun anymore.
They were different. And so when I saw the show, it was a huge moment to see the freedom with which they were doing their comedy. But most importantly to me, they were presupposed a level of intelligence in their audience that you couldn't do then in America.
They got huge reaction. First of all, it was so different from anything. They were used to seeing Masterpiece Theater and all these wonderful, noble programs. Here comes this completely insane British humor show. Suddenly, people understood British humor. Isn't that amazing?
And now for something completely different.
I was always quite, you know, excited about Now for Something Completely Different. You know, it's kind of, people tend to run it down nowadays, so it wasn't a proper Python film. It was a movie, you know, it was shown in movie theatres. We went to some previews.
Victor Lowndes had loved the show. He was the Playboy Club in London, and he thought it was a great show. And he did a deal, I think, with Columbia. And he put up, I think the budget was $80 million. No, $80,000. Is that possible? Yes, it must have been.
He is the one who was located in London and a huge fan of the Pythons and encouraged me to do the film.
And they had done it especially for the American market, was the idea. They didn't want it shown in England, really.
Good morning. I'm a bank robber. Please don't panic. Just hand over all the money.
This is a lingerie shop, sir.
They got Ian McNaughton to direct, and we did the best of sketches. And it wasn't a very happy experience because we weren't in charge of it. We didn't have final cut. Ian tended to be drunk by lunchtime, so we'd just get on with it anyway.
I know that really Terry Jones wanted to direct it and was sort of, you know, didn't feel it was quite how we should be doing what we should be doing.
This is a frightened city. Over these streets, over these houses, hangs a pall of fear. An ugly kind of violence is rife, stalking the town. Yes, gangs of old ladies attacking fit, defenseless young men.
We sort of twisted the arm of Columbia Pictures and got it out here. But it wasn't a huge box office success. Got some very nice reviews. That started, it helped.
I remember going in 1971 on Yonge Street in Toronto. My friend Dave Bennett took me. Maybe we smoked something. Maybe we didn't, but it didn't matter. It was just great, solid, absurdist out there humor.
We have a lot of trouble with these grannies. Pension day's the worst. As soon as they get it, they blow the lot on milk, tea, sugar, a tin of meat for the cat.
It actually connected really well, sketch to sketch, and was just so ridiculously silly.
I'm warning this film not to get silly again.
They could leave before you tied up the plot, the least interesting part of the sketch. And so it was a huge advance. And they were very, just seemed very free.
Dear sir, I would like to complain about that last scene about people falling out of high buildings. I myself have worked all my life in such a building and have never once...
It is what it is. It's just a collection of the, you know, the first series and a bit more.
It lacked the Python input, and so it's okay. I mean, some of the sketches are done quite well, but it wasn't that interesting. And it gave us the incentive to want to make our own film. I think that was the basic thing about it, which has led to saying, well, next time we will write our own film, we'll direct our own film, and that will be fine.
The important thing about making a film of our own, as opposed to now something completely different, was that we should do something that was more integrated. It was, you know, we're very much aware, if you've got 90 minutes there, how do you get something that runs 90 minutes, holds people's attention for 90 minutes? And Terry J, particularly, was very keen on a story. And he and I had written various storylines for some of the early Python shows, like the Pither, the bicycling sketch, almost was a full half hour. So this idea that narrative is very important, that, you know, involves the audience much more, so we can't just do sketches.
We said, well, we write our own film, and so we set about writing, and then in Python way, we just start to write, and all this stuff comes in.
The writing went round and round and round for a long time. How we finally honed it down to what it was quite... I can't even remember.
I remember that Terry and I had written, maybe for the Python fourth series or something like that, we'd written something about knights approaching a castle and talking about, you know, the unladen swallow and all that, where is your master and all that sort of thing. And I think we got the coconuts were in there as well.
A little bit of it is about this, you know, the coconut and King Arthur. And then another little bit is King Arthur in Harrods and looking for the Grail in the Grail department. And there's other bits about boxing championship. It's a huge mishmash.
And I think you'll find that about 85% of it went out. I mean, we threw away almost all of that first draft and gradually staggered towards something that approached a little bit more of a story.
And we put it away, and we come back in 2 or 3 months, and it was clear on rereading that the interesting bit was the Grail and the Holy... So we said, all right, OK, toss the rest of it out, second rewrite, let's concentrate on making this the story of Arthur.
And people came back saying, yeah, the good thing about something like the search for the Grail is we could each have a character, but we'd also play lots of other characters. So we could each be a knight, but we could do the subsidiary characters as well.
Everybody did a lot of research. That's the good thing. Everybody read, you know, the Grail stories and Arthur.
Because we were quite, you know, we were sort of library nerds, really, all of us brought up to respect reference books and all that. So we did quite a bit of reading.
And that's what happened for the next 2 or 3 rewrites. And so we have this semi-tight script with a crap ending.
It's such a loose story that you can go in all sorts of directions. But at the end, you know, that it is about the quest for the Grail. And so long as we can resolve the ending, then we've got something which appears to be a good, strong narrative film.
It sort of came out in about 73 that they needed money to make Holy Grail.
The problem with raising money was that they'd already done and now for something completely different. So the idea of making another Python film didn't seem to warrant.
Because nobody in the British film industry, as it was then, which was essentially Rank and EMI, were prepared to put up anything for it.
Now we need money to finance it, and we went to... I think Graham had a friend called Tony Stratton-Smith,
who was a rock and roll record owner and bon viveur.
And Tony Stratton-Smith grandly said, well, we'll raise the money, we can do it.
And I think Steve O'Rourke, our manager, knew Tony well. And so there was a sort of obvious connection there.
And I remember sending the copies of the film, our little 60-millimeter copy of Enough for Something Completely Different, out to various people, bands on the road here. Some of whom didn't respond. Others, he got money from Led Zeppelin and Pink Floyd, definitely, and Charisma put up a chunk as well.
No, I think we thought it would work, and I think we, by then, were fans, and it seemed like a really, really good idea.
You can't sort of underestimate, you know, how big they were at the time, much, much bigger than us. And we were kind of quite stage-struck by the fact that these people might even know about Python, let alone want to put some money into it.
The actual budget that was offered to them was £150,000.
And the good news was they were rock and roll people and they didn't want to tell us interfere. They didn't want to read the script. So it was great backing, the best backing to have.
The important thing was for Python to have complete control and final cut and all the things they needed
to do things in their own way.
And off we went. It seems forever ago. Is forever ago a word? I don't know. I mean, but it seems that way. Of course, Terry and I, the two desperate filmmakers who hadn't made films before, said, you know, anybody named Terry gets to direct this film, and everybody seemed to agree.
We're really learning as we do it. That's what's nice. We've been given a whole feature film to learn how to make films on.
Charlie, you come to this mark there, where Suko is.
We do tag team directing. And he finishes that, he'll come out here and exhaustedly tap me on the shoulder, and I'll rush into action, and away we'll go.
One of the problems we had was that we had two directors, neither of whom had ever directed a film before. Plus the fact they're both loonies.
I think it's quite difficult to have two directors. And I think the idea was that Terry Jones would be doing a lot of acting anyway, therefore when he was doing the acting, Terry Gilliam could come in and do that. Because Terry was playing Sir Bedivere in a scene doesn't suddenly mean he's not interested in how that scene looks. Of course he wants to direct everything, and Terry Gilliam probably wanted to direct everything, but they had to sort of share it. It didn't altogether work out.
The big difference between Terry Jones and Terry Gilliam is Terry Jones is much more shooting from the hip. It's almost the action can flow because he's almost shooting it like a documentary at times. And he shoots pretty fast, on schedule and all the rest of it. And Terry Gilliam is worrying about the visual details much more.
It was great for the movie because in the movie you get these wonderful Gilliam scenes of the boat, and so it becomes actually a movie, whereas Terry Jones is very good at making sure the joke is on camera.
You know, Terry is a perfectionist, and so he would be spending time on the getting shots. And I remember him getting really angry with me because, you know, I'd come out the way maybe he was directing, and I'd come onto the set and we hadn't shot anything or something like that by 10 o'clock in the morning. And so I started hurrying up, getting things moving quicker, and I think Terry probably resented that a bit.
And we were also trying to work out how the two of us worked together, which was interesting, because in preparation we all seemed, he and I shared exactly the same ideas. It became clear very quickly that when we actually got onto the floor shooting that we weren't saying the same thing, which was confusing for the crew.
One Terry had come along in the morning and set up the lighting, blah, 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 and then went off. And then the other Terry came along in the afternoon and said, nope, don't like that, change it.
So Jerry Harrison, who was the first AD, became the common voice between the two Terrys. But then very quickly we discovered he was making his own film, which wasn't, so he was saying what neither of us was saying. And ultimately it settled down with Terry dealing with the group, the actors, and me back with the camera, trying to set up shots and get that done. And that worked very well, and that's how we got through the film.
But, I mean, you're all treating them with proper respect.
Well, I mean, there's never been any mutual respect within the Python group at all, as you probably know, but we're withholding a lot of the criticism that we would normally be making.
Certain members of the group actually exploited the difference between the fact that we had two directors and would sort of say things like, oh, no, Terry Gilliam wouldn't get us to do that, or Terry Jones wouldn't ask us to do that if Terry Gilliam was directing. And I thought that was a bit unfair and unhelpful.
They're doing a grand job. Well, I mean, I love, you know, I mean, I can't say anything. I adore them all, and I think everything they do is so well. But they know they're working very well together, and it works.
I think Gellers realized directing Python is basically a dog's body job. So they were happy that these two, you know, energetic guys with the same name could go out and run around and do all the stuff.
It really has just got to organize things and work out what you're doing in the morning, and it's a very thankless task.
It was wonderful because, I mean, I'd always wanted to be a film director, but I saw no way to get there, and so when finally it's handed to us on a plate, it's fantastic.
And now, the big one! Come on, Concord!
In a movie of 6 weeks, you probably do three great takes. You know what I mean? Others are okay. You know? And we did one really great take.
I remember Cleese and I, we'd be doing this Message for you, sir, scene. Message for you, sir.
And we did a really funny take. And at the end of it, Terry shouted, cut. And I said, how about that? Because I was really pleased with it.
Brave, brave Concord. You shall not have died in vain.
I'm not quite dead, sir.
Well, you shall not have been mortally wounded in vain.
Terry Gilliam said, not enough smoke.
That's when I get angry.
And for an actor, that's freaking not enough smoke. I should have learned then not to have been in Munchausen, because there was too much smoke in Munchausen, you know.
When they say more smoke, and this kind of thing, because we've hardly had a shot yet when we haven't had smoke or some arty visual effect, we tend to ask them how many laughs there are in the smoke, you know, just to keep them, as it were, thinking of that. But that's the only criticism I've made.
I'll just stay here then, shall I, sir? Yeah.
But I think that movies, like television, they attract people who are really fundamentally fascinated by the visuals, and therefore you get a slant. Do you see what I mean? Even people writing about movies tend to be slanted towards the visual, when in fact it's a total experience, not just a visual experience. And people say to me, but movies, you know, movies are a visual experience. And I say to them, life is a visual experience, but here we are sitting talking.
Both Terry and I were very keen on Pasolini's films because they were always done in real places. You could smell them, you could feel it. The textures, the sounds and everything were all real. And that was what we were trying to achieve, just that kind of reality. And I think in the end we achieved a lot because nobody had done comedy like that before, where you were so immersed in the time and place and the filth.
Who's that then?
I don't know. Must be a king.
Why?
He hasn't got shit all over him.
The jokes work better if you really believe in that world, so that when they say, you know, how do you know he's a king? Because he doesn't have shit all over him. That works because the world is just steeped in mud and filth and depredation. And that was important to those jokes.
There is some lovely filth down here.
Oh, how'd you do?
How do you do, good lady? I am Arthur, King of the Britons. Whose castle is that?
King of the who?
The Britons.
Who are the Britons?
It was very, very wet and very damp and very dirty. And there was a lot of whinging going on, a lot of complaining, mainly from John, must say, because John didn't like discomfort at all.
There was one scene which Terry Gilliam was directing when we were all in armour and we were kneeling down. I think it was the cow scene, and he was trying to get the composition right.
We have been charged by God with a sacred quest. If he will give us food and shelter for the night, he may join us in our holy quest for the Grail.
Well, I'll ask him, but I don't think he'll be very keen. He's already got one, you see?
What? He says they've already got one. Are you sure he's got one?
Oh, yes, it's very nice, sir.
I told them we already got one.
Trying to get them to get in the right position so we could actually have all the animals coming over the battlement and their heads weren't sticking above what would be the mat line.
Of course, the armor was not very comfortable, and he was really moving us sort of this much to the left and this, and then can you lower your head that much? And I remember making some remark about the fact that he normally did his animation with little bits of cutouts. It was easy to do that, but if you were a human being in armor that was sort of cutting into your knees, that there was a limit to the final perfection that could be achieved.
And Ollie kept doing, John in particular, and Graham grousing about the positions I was putting him in.
We had an argument, and I think I was rude to him. And as far as he went off and lay in the shadow of a wall for some time.
I just stormed off that day and said, you know, fuck it, you know, you wrote the sketch, I'm trying to make it work. If you don't like it, fuck off. And I went and got all humpy and sat in the grass while Terry took over.
But I think I hurt his feelings, and I'm sorry I did that, but...
That's about the only time I've lost it with Python.
It was as though we were bits of cardboard cut out. You know, there wasn't a great understanding that we're human beings.
It's very difficult on Holy Grail for me to make the transition from a man who commanded paper to move to a man who was requesting other members of the group to move. I don't know, I hadn't developed the use of language or the whip, either one, at that point. And that was difficult. We managed to do it. That's why Holy Grail was a very abrupt learning experience for me, because I had to begin to be able to speak to the others and convince them why they should, you know, stand in mud up to their neck.
We get on the hillside at 7 in the morning. At 7:12, the rain would come down. We'd all be huddling under this. The knitted string chain mail would get damp.
No, it was like that. I mean, we wore woolen armour, and you could tell what time of day it was by how far up your legs the damp had penetrated.
And then at the end of the day, when the first assistant director shouted, "It's a wrap," the scurry, the rush, the scrum to get in a car and get back to the hotel, because there was only enough hot water in the hotel for about 50% of the guests.
And we were staying in the same hotel as the crew because we were kind of right on, you know.
So people raced back to get their shower or their bath before everyone else. There was dirty work going on as people were tripping each other and trying to get in the bus.
Finally, John and I got fed up, and we moved off to this. We found there was a hydro hotel down the road, 25 minutes away, and we checked in there, and there was big hot water baths, and oh, great and great. And then all the girls from Anthrax Castle came in, and we went, yes! Thank you.
And here in Castle Anthrax, we have but one punishment for setting alight the Grail-shaped beacon. You must tie her down on a bed and spank her.
It's fine.
You must spank her well, and after you have spanked her, you may deal with her as you like. And then, spank me.
And spank me?
And me?
And me?
Yes, yes, you must give us all a good spank.
I played all sorts of things with Monty, from sort of young girls to old ladies, from men to nuns to what have you. And they came to me with a script and they said, "Oh, Carol, this one is going to be a bit difficult. This you might have to work at a bit." And I said, "Well, what is it?" I said, "Oh, Carol, I don't know if you're going to be able to carry this off." I said, "What? What is it?" I said, "A 19-year-old virgin, Carol." So I'm trying my best.
Shit!
We were in the nick of time. You were in great peril.
I don't think I was.
Yes, you were. You were in terrible peril.
Look, let me go back in there and face the peril.
No, it's too perilous.
Look, my duty as a knight is to sample as much peril as I can.
No, we've got to find the Holy Grail. Come on. Don't let me have just a little bit of peril.
No, don't help me. Bet you're gay.
We were not being, like, you know, proper directors and producers being nice to people. We were just trying to get through it. Terry and I were just exhausted.
We did have to shoot such a lot. I mean, the Knights Who Say Nee sequence starts with Bedivere and Arthur sitting around a campfire, and I think that sequence, the whole going through the woods sequence, was shot in one day, which is like, it's almost 10 minutes of cut film.
We are the Knights Who Say Nee!
No, not nee, the Knights Who Say Nee.
The same!
10 minutes of cut film, that's a lot of material. And, like, by the end of the day, I remember Terry and I were saying, what happens next? Where the Robin and his minstrels have got to come in? OK, so which side should they come in from? Oh, God. And nobody having it. The cameraman didn't know, Terry didn't know, I didn't know. We had absolutely just... It was working in such a panic.
Surely you've not given up your quest for the Holy Grail.
He is sneaking away and buzzering off.
No, far from it.
I'm running Holy Grail, and I'm worried about the logistics. And Terry Jones would always come, "Jules, I wonder if..." And then he would ask for something that was just almost the impossible thing that I could never produce, and I would have to produce it. So it was terribly worrying as he approached me every time. He was mainly in his Bedivere costume. So I used to see this costume coming towards me, and it was like this dread of the costume coming towards me. Even when he wasn't there, there was somebody else in it, and I, oh, God, you know, Terry's going to ask me for something, you know. What is he going to ask me for that I'm not expecting? And how the hell am I going to do it on this sort of budget?
The budget was low on Holy Grail, but it wasn't any different from the BBC. I mean, the budget was low in the BBC. Filming was always a rush, you know, to get everything filmed in time.
They were used to running around with a 16mm camera shooting, you know, sketches on Ben Nevis or whatever. And I remember travelling around with Terry Gilliam and Terry Jones to look at the location.
One day, lad, all this will be yours.
What, the curtains?
No, not the curtains, lad. All that you can see stretched out over the hills and valleys of this land. That'll be your kingdom, lad.
We'd gone over Scotland and we'd gone over Wales, actually, and decided on Scotland in the end. And we'd chosen a whole lot of castles all over Scotland that looked great.
And they would say, oh, this is great, this castle in Scotland. And then in the afternoon, we can travel to Killin and shoot the cave. And I'm saying, yeah, but, you know, feature film, we've got costumes, we've got makeup, we've got piles of stuff and extras. We can't just shoot in the morning one place, travel 100 miles or 200 miles and shoot in the afternoon the other place. It doesn't work like that on features.
And then about 2 weeks before we were actually due to start filming, we got a letter from the Department of the Environment for Scotland telling us that we couldn't use any of their castles because they considered that we'd be doing things that were inconsistent with the
dignity of the fabric of the building, that a bit of jokery might undermine all the blood spilling that had gone out of those castles. I thought it was just extraordinary.
So we had to go up the week before we started filming to find some privately owned, non-nationalised castles that we could use. And the only one we really found was Doon Castle.
Camelot.
And that had to stand in for all the castles. It had to stand for Camelot, it had to stand for every castle in the film. Actually, we found it was a great thing in the end because it meant we were just located in Doon most of the time and we didn't have to change around, which would have taken up time. So it meant we got more done.
It was just a strange scramble. And in the midst of all this, everything was going wrong because we get up to Glencoe, we get up there and the first day shooting, the camera breaks.
I'd made a camera that you could carry up a mountain. I'd had somebody engineer a zoom front, and we had a much lighter camera that was an invention that we created just for the film.
Cameraman suddenly said, hey, wait a minute, something's gone wrong. And he opened up the camera and all the gears fell out. And it had just, the camera just sheared its gears. We only had one camera that was shooting sound, and the only other camera we had was a mute camera.
So we'll shoot on a wild camera, just get any old wild camera. It doesn't matter if you shoot sync. We've got enough noise of explosions and smoke. Just shoot, and I'll go and try and get it fixed.
And what do? We shoot close-ups, which could have done practically in somebody's back garden rather than shooting the expanse. You know, it was great, in a sense, to be, you know, much of the responsibility was taken off our shoulders because anything was better than nothing at this point.
The first week of Holy Grail, I had planned only to have the pythons themselves with their costumes just wandering around the locale up in Glencoe.
In the end shot of the army rushing down and being the police stopping the army and arresting Arthur and Bedivere was supposed to take place weeks later in Stirling.
Couldn't we get the charge up here? We wanted to do the charge up in the West Coast. And Hazel, our costume designer, said, well, we just haven't got the costumes and we won't have the costumes for another 5 weeks until the end of the shooting to costume 200 people charging.
So we got everybody's child, everybody was around to hold up banners and pike staffs in front of the camera and a few helmets we had, so you see those, and we set up very, very carefully, and you'd swear there's an army there, but there wasn't.
Our lasting image of Terry as a director was Terry organising this. We had a few passers-by who would come to watch the filming, and there was about a dozen of them, and some little children and things like that. So there's Terry, put a helmet on some of the little child, you know, and given her a spear to carry. So all you see is the army charging, which was shot 5 weeks later, the 200 students charging down the hill slope, and then then the frame, you see Castle Stalker, and then the army comes into shot, and it's a head down there and a spear up there, and, of course, it's just a little child and some children holding spears and things. And Terry got it absolutely spot on.
It was madness rushing around because we had very little transport. Everybody was having to drive themselves. Everybody was exhausted. I mean, people were going off the roads at night.
there was a bad atmosphere on the set, and I didn't know what was going on. And the crew didn't seem very happy. Nobody seemed very happy.
They were so cold, they were so tired. There were murmurings of dissent from the crew.
It was lovely Graham who sort of saved the day. We were staying in this hotel, and it was the first time we were going to see any of the rushes. So everyone, all the crew, and everyone was invited for the rushes, and everyone was very grumpy and miserable. And Graham sort of came to the rescue straight away, get everybody in the right mood, and he said, right, drinks on me. So, of course, that helped. By the time we went to see the rushes, everyone had a few, were being a bit merry, and it turned out the rushes looked spectacular, just looked so wonderful.
And when they saw the rushes, people were so astounded by the quality they'd produced and the quantity they'd produced that they said, they all relaxed and they said, right, we're going for this.
So the next day, everybody was happier. In fact, I believe the crew actually agreed to work for, half their wages or something. So it changed everything.
It's about a search for the Holy Grail, you see, which is a large sort of creature, a bit like a dodo, with a big beak. And people are trying to find this grail.
If you will not show us the grail, we shall take your castle by force.
You don't frighten us, English pig dogs. Go and boil your bottom, sons of a silly person. I'll blow my nose at you, so-called Arthur King. You and all your silly English kniggets.
And the whole film is a great anticlimax.
I see, and that starts fairly soon after the credit titles, doesn't it?
It does, yes. Starts and immediately.
In immediately, after the census certificate.
In comes the anticlimax.
And Graham is a fantastic actor. Is, because you still see him doing fantastic acting in those films.
Graham was the right choice for Arthur. I mean, there's a dignity about him and a seriousness there, everything about it, which is fantastic. Because we discovered there was a leading man in the group, and it was Graham. I always thought it was going to be Mike, but it turned out to be Graham.
Old woman!
Man!
Ma'am, sorry. What knight lives in that castle over there?
I'm 37.
What?
I'm 37. I'm not old.
Well, I can't just call you man.
You could say Dennis.
I didn't know you were called Dennis.
Well, you didn't bother to find out, did you?
I did say sorry about the old woman, but from behind you looked...
What I object to is you automatically treat me like an inferior.
Well, I am king.
Oh, king, eh? Very nice.
Graham was drinking when we were doing Holy Grail. I remember one morning him looking up at an aeroplane and saying, oh, just think of all those people drinking their gin and tonics, you know. And I thought, well, I look at an aeroplane one way and Graham looks at an aeroplane another in terms of a gin and tonic.
What's it like being a film star?
I'm not. I'm just an extra, really.
You're just an extra?
Yes.
Oh.
It's the crown and this that probably...
Yeah, I was looking for Graham thing.
Ah, yes, he's around somewhere.
Is he?
Yes, here he is.
Well, of course, we didn't know that Graham was alcoholic. Well, we knew he liked to drink.
And he became so antagonistic towards Terry and myself because us little jumped-up shits were ruining his picture because Ian McNaughton, who had directed the television shows and had directed And Now Something Completely Different, had been sidelined. And he was a man who knew how to get things done. And we were destroying everything. And he would go on these drunken rampages at night where we could barely stand up out of sheer exhaustion. And there's Graham screaming. And of course, then you go on the day trying to get through a shot. And Graham was so unable to remember his lines. We wouldn't get things done. It was... I don't know how we did it, frankly.
But the Grail! Where is the Grail?
Seek you the Bridge of Death.
The Bridge of Death, which leads to the Grail?
The first time we realised there was anything wrong was on the first shot, which was the Bridge of Death in the Gorge of Eternal Peril. We had the six of us, in fact, standing on the edge of this precipice on a small path.
We're up there and these mountaineers have built this Bridge of Death, which is terrifying, and I would not go near it, let alone across it.
We get there, we're ready to shoot, and Graham, the great mountaineer, the man who had done all the tales of climbing this, that, and another mountain, couldn't walk across the bridge. He just froze.
And he was shaking, and I'm thinking, you're supposed to be a mountaineer. We're up on a mountain and you're shaking.
And so why was like that? He seemed to be afraid of heights. But anyway, didn't have time to think about it.
In fact, we were halfway up a mountainside in Glencoe and I hadn't got my daily dose. And it was 7 o'clock in the morning that we left the hotel. The bar wasn't open. I hadn't realised this. I hadn't gotten anything prepared the night before as I should have if I'd researched my drinking properly.
Once you've got the shakes and the tremors, that is a physicality, which means you can't really put one foot in front of the other.
I had DTs on the mountainside while having to try and remember lines and stand up.
And so it's Jerry Harrison, the assistant director, in Graham's clothes, going across the bridge.
I don't think we ever put together that it was alcoholism and there was a problem and he needed help. There was no support for him in that sense.
It was then that I decided next time that I do a job like this, I'm going to be clean for it. It's not fair to the other chaps in the group. It's not fair to me. It's not fair to what I've written. It's very stupid. And so when I next had a patch of time in which I thought I would need to recover, I took that patch of time and recovered after, well, I suppose, really 3 days of hell.
It was pretty amazing that we shot in 5 weeks and nothing really went materially wrong until post-production when it clearly wasn't working.
I mean, the hardest thing for them was to edit. Because in the Jonesy would edit by day and Gillian would edit by night, and there was only one editor. It's like, what a nightmare for him.
Holy Grail was a disaster, the first showing we had of the Holy Grail.
I mean, Grail had, in the end, 13 edits from the very first screening we did with 100 people, which was just not good.
The film started and people laughed. That is, it actually, at that point, we opened with the Bring Out Your Dead sequence.
Bring out your dead!
Here's one. Ninepence.
I'm not dead.
What? Nothing. Here's your ninepence.
I'm not dead.
There. He says he's not dead.
Yes, he is.
And people started laughing and they laughed for about 5 minutes and then, dead. Absolutely zilch. The whole film played. Nobody laughing. And it was just the most awful evening, I think. And the only thing I could think of was that we'd done a film before, which was a compilation film, and in that was the Dirty Fork sketch.
No apologies I can make can alter the fact that in our restaurant you have been given a dirty, filthy, smelly piece of cutlery.
Was it smelly?
It was smelly and obscene and disgusting. And I hate it, I hate it, I hate it. Nasty, grubby, dirty, mangy, scrubby little dog.
And that had been very funny when we did it on TV. And it wasn't funny when we showed it in the cinema. It didn't get any laughs. And the only thing I could see different was that Ian McNaughton had put on some Muzak over the scene. And so we took the Muzak off and it then got laughs again. So I kind of thought, well, maybe the same thing's happening with the Holy Grail.
The music budget was, I think, £3,000. And I could afford 12 musicians for about 8 sessions.
What are you exactly contributing to the film?
Terror and heroics in certain points to really do a job, you know, with the music to sort of either create the lump in the throat or make the back hairs stick out.
I'd written some pretty good, I thought, Arthurian themes, you know, with two French horns sort of in harmony, sort of going bum ba bum ba 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 bum orchestra da 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 da. But you play it with 12 people and it sounds like a sort of an afternoon's alternative activities at the Women's Institute. And so, you know, Terry rang me up and said, it's awful, I know, but, you know, really, you know, we can't have all the other cheap jokes and have thin music. We've got to go to the library. And I perfectly understand and, that is the correct decision. 147 musicians playing any old thing is better than 12 playing something beautiful.
I mean, I think the music made a huge difference by using library music and COD heroics. It just gave it a whole other aspect.
The bits I did do stayed in with the kind of little medieval bits, the jaunty little medieval music.
Bravely bold Sir Robin, brought forth from Camelot. He was not afraid to die, oh brave Sir Robin.
And of course the music for When Knights of the Round Table. To push the pram a lot.
I have to push the pram a lot.
No, on second thoughts, let's not go to Camelot. It is a silly place.
And bit by bit, we've sort of put it together. We linked up the laughs and through shot at little linky bits where the gorilla porn.
Come on, come on. That's an offensive weapon, that is.
Come on, back with us. Back.
I ended the Holy Grail because we didn't have an end for that either. And I said, well, why don't we just have the police arrest it and put the hand over the camera? My daughter hates me for that. She says, the shittiest ending of a movie ever. I hate you, Dad.
All right, sonny, that's enough. Just pack that in.
But then we'd be so nervous about it that, you know, and we'd get people in and we'd get a sort of into a small viewing theatre and we'd have 20 people or something. You say, well, you know, what do you think? And the people would watch it and they'd say, well, yeah, it's all right, but nobody was very keen on it. And then eventually we were, Terry Gilliam and I were going out with this film that we thought was a turkey to a film festival in Los Angeles. And there we had a paying audience for the first time and we showed the film to a big audience and they laughed. And it was kind of like, oh, they laughed, you know, they laughed, I think they laughed. And then, of course, we realised that, A, it's a paying audience who paid their money, they're going to want to laugh. And the other thing was, you don't ever say to anybody, we're really worried about this comedy film, would you come and look and see if you think it's funny? Because they're not going to find it funny.
My favorite Monty Python movie is Holy Grail. It has to be. It's just amazing.
From the first second the thing starts, just that. Just the fact that they were taking themselves so seriously was instantly funny.
It is set up like any other epic film, except that when you see them riding on horses, it's just a dude hopping along, and another guy carrying all his stuff, clip-clopping with coconuts. And then they get off on a philosophical debate of the migration instincts of tropical birds, and perhaps, you know what I mean? It all becomes these mundane assessments of absolutely ridiculous things.
The swallow may fly south with the sun, or the house martin or the plover may seek warmer climes in winter, yet these are not strangers to our land.
Are you suggesting coconuts migrate?
Not at all. They could be carried.
What? A swallow carrying a coconut?
It could grip it by the husk.
It's not a question of where he grips it. It's a simple question of weight ratios. A 5-ounce bird could not carry a 1-pound coconut.
Well, it doesn't matter.
Things like the knights arriving with the coconut shells and stuff like that, still great idea, and mixed in with this film that is that wonderful sort of realism of medieval England with all the mud was probably rather better than anything that's been done recently.
Not only is it very funny, it's also very affectionate in terms of its treatment of the Grail legends and incredibly faithful to the actual story.
The wise Sir Bedivere was the first to join King Arthur's knights. But other illustrious names were soon to follow. Sir Lancelot the Brave, Sir Galahad the Pure, and Sir Robin, the not quite so brave as Sir Lancelot.
My brother can lip sync the whole fucking film. And I'm not exaggerating. From the moment it starts, he's there. I can't watch the film with him in the room.
Now look
here, my good man.
I don't want to talk to you no more, you empty-headed animal food trough whopper. I fart in your general direction. Your mother was a hamster and your father smelt of elderberries.
And apparently Elvis' favourite film, Holy Grail, watched it about 45 times in the Graceland private cinema. You can imagine Elvis watching Holy Grail. What a superb image that would be.
Elvis loved it. I mean, he was laughing so much that eyes were just tearing.
Come, Patsy.
None shall pass.
What?
None shall pass.
I have no quarrel with you, good Sir Knight, but I must cross this bridge.
Then you shall die.
The scene, though, that Elvis used to imitate, the sword fight scene. We played a lot of football, and one time we were playing, and you know, he literally broke his finger. Oh, you okay, Elvis? Merely a flesh wound. And he did it just like the movie.
Look, you stupid bastard, you've got no arms left.
Yes, I have.
Look,
it's just a flesh wound.
Because I was the hugest Elvis fan. That was, like, so weird and sort of trippy just to think that Elvis was a Python fan doing those voices.
Come, Patsy.
Oh, I see. Running away, eh? You yellow bastard! Come back here and take what's coming to you! I'll bite your legs off!
Just the very idea of Elvis knowing those catchphrases and him being as annoying as my brother as well, sat next to Priscilla on the sofa. It's just a flesh wound.
I like the image of Elvis Presley reciting Python lines. That's pop culture reaches its apotheosis in that moment. There's nothing Andy Warhol can do about that.
The Castle Arc. Our quest is at an end.
Holy Grail was number one for weeks in America, you know. For a £200,000 film, it was amazing, you know.
By the time it came out here, it was 1975. The TV series had been on. We were getting some great publicity. The Python trademark was becoming known.
I used to look in Variety, you know, and it was like looking at your bank account, you know. So you'd buy Variety and look up, you know, oh, it's number one and it's made another billion, it's £1 million, you know, in which I get my 2.5%. Great, you know.
We'd done this promotional ad to give out free coconuts to the first 100 or however many people were going to turn up at the cinema. There was a full-page ad in the Times. Well, there was a line around the block. And they had to start open the movie even earlier. It was tremendous. It was very exciting.
It was at the opening of Holy Grail in New York, and there was a question from a journalist. He said, so what's your next movie? And I said, Jesus Christ, Lust for Glory.
Everyone knows the inspiring story and life of the child born in a manger. This isn't that story. It's not that life.
Brian, the babe they call Brian.
This is Monty Python's Life of Brian. It was the golden age of Roman rule.
Do we have any crucifixions today? 139, sir. Special celebration.
A time of miracles.
I was blind and now I can see.
Of imperial benevolence.
Hell fever!
It's absolutely clear!
It was a time when getting stoned wasn't breaking the law. It was the law. For the people of Jerusalem, things were looking bad.
Got a few crosses left.
And then Brian dropped in. Wasn't the Messiah. He was a very naughty boy.
Terrific race, the Romans. Terrific.